Dale Nichols. We've developed these tapes to show wire wrapping and wire artist techniques to form very nice pieces of jewelry. I've been wire wrapping about 15 years now, and for most of those years I've also been teaching. All I do now is teach various locations throughout the United States. I think that's helped me prepare these tapes, which I consider the finest tapes ever done on wire artistry, to be very good for both beginners and more experienced wire wrap artists. Before we get started, I'd like to show you some of the projects that are on the tapes. There are projects that are on the tapes that are not here on the table. In addition to these projects, there are many, many others that can be found from various sources. Before we get into the projects, I'd like to cover some basics about tools, about wire, and a couple of techniques. You can carry all the tools you need to do wire art in a shoebox, and you can spend less than $100 and have a very acceptable selection of tools to do this work. The most fundamental and most often used of the tools are pliers, and there are four sets of pliers that are essential. There's some others that you may want to buy as you go along, and I'll cover those a little bit later. But right now, the essential set of pliers are the flat nose, the round nose, these are chain nose, and what I call, and what most people in wire call, flush cutters. First, I'll cover the pliers. They all need to have some common characteristics. That is that the jaw length from the hinge to the jaw, that is from here to the end of the jaw, needs to be an inch to an inch and a quarter. They all need to be light tight at the end when you hold them up to the light and look through the end. All three of these pliers, the chain nose, the flat nose, and the round nose, need to come together when they are together, need to come to a point not more than about a 1/16 of an inch. The flat nose should be roughly 3/16 of an inch wide. And the round nose and the chain nose should come to a 1/16 of an inch at the end of the jaw as well, and a 1/16 of an inch at the end of the jaws in the profile view. Jaw length, again, should be about 1/8 of an inch. Now, this said, I almost won't buy pliers without picking them up and feeling. Different pliers feel different in your hands. You'll find that some very nice pliers or expensive pliers don't feel as good to you as the less expensive pliers. Each of these pliers, with the exception of these, cost in the $7 to $10 range. So now these flush cutters are beading pliers. And the reason we call them flush cutters is that when we pick it up, when we cut a piece of wire with the flat side, it cuts it square and thereby eliminates burrs. The more traditional diagonal cutters that have bevel jaws on both sides cut wire in a, there's a peak on each end of the wire, and invariably there's a little burr on it. So we use the flush cutters. As I said, these are the beading pliers. You can find these at any beading shop or through jewelry suppliers. And again, they cost $7 to $10. I've had all of these pliers for many, many years. They're not necessarily expensive pliers, with the exception of these. These are very expensive. They're good German pliers. And I think they were in the $50 range when I bought them, but they've lasted a lot. You can also find duplicates of this plier, either manufactured in either Pakistan or China, for a lot less money than I paid for those. Okay, some other tools that you'll use regularly are a file. This is a small escapement file. I bought this from a jewelry supplier. It's a very fine grit, and you need to prepare this file before you use it. To use this file, I put it in a wooden handle that gives you much better control as far as keeping it from moving from side to side. I also prepare the edges by smoothing them with a little grinding wheel. And in my case, I use an abrasive stone that comes with the Dremel, and I'll discuss the Dremel in more detail a little bit later, but you just put that in, turn it on, and you run it right along that edge, and that takes all the serrations off the edge. And the reason for that is that when you're using it on an article of jewelry, is that you can file right next to a stone or next to another piece of wire. And if you slip, you don't mark it, or you don't scratch the stone. Frankly, most of the, and use this for deburring, most of the deburring work I do with a Dremel, which I'll demonstrate a little bit later. But occasionally you need that. Use the Sharpie pen, either in the fine or ultra fine, is the only thing that really makes a satisfactory mark on wire jewelry as you're working on it. So you can make a mark like that. Frequently it'll come off as you develop the piece, but if it doesn't, you can take a fingernail polish remover or acetone, paint thinner, and take it right off. But you need a Sharpie, and you can get that at any office supply. I use a toothbrush and Windex for cleaning jewelry when I'm on the road. When we get through, we polish the jewelry. You can use a jeweler's polishing cloth, or again, I use the Dremel with a wheel, which I'll demonstrate a little bit later. This wheel is a soft cotton buff, and I use that with jeweler's rouge, just like that, and you just touch it like that. Jeweler's cloth is you can use to, you know, stroke the jewelry, and it will also polish the jewelry. Use tweezers occasionally for picking up small pieces. These articles you can find at jewelry supply place, some times at a swap meet. The best place, though, is at gem and mineral shows or bead shows. They have good tools of the right kind, and they're available there at a good price. If you're going to do rings, you need a ring sizer. You use this on the customer or whoever you're making the ring for. It gives you a size, and then you can transfer that size to a ring mandrel. And when you buy a ring mandrel, you need to buy one that is perfectly round. There's another type that has a groove back for working on faceted stones, but the majority of your work will be on a round ring mandrel, and it's got the sizes marked at each location. I use a smaller, we won't call this a mandrel, it's actually a drift punch. It's a mechanics tool, and it's a much smaller, it goes from diameter than the ring mandrel. It goes from, oh, probably a quarter of an inch up to a half. And we use this to fit stones in, to get an exact fit for stones in rings, both faceted rings and cabochons. The next tool I use is a small metal ball peen hammer. It's very light. Again, I polish the surface with the Dremel tool and take the wire edge off so that if I hit a piece of an article of jewelry, as I'm tapping on it, if I happen to hit it off square, it doesn't mark or cut the jewelry. There are three measuring devices you need. You can use a yardstick or a carpenter's tape for measuring longer pieces. You can use a regular ruler for intermediate cutting. And then for the very fine work, I use a metal scale. This is available at the bigger home at Home Depot's, Lowe's, and those kinds of companies. And you need to buy one that is absolutely easy to read. This one's very clearly marked, and so I like this one. I think it's only a couple of dollars at Home Depot or home supply store. There are others. You need to look at this very carefully, because when you are making some projects, particularly the faceted stone projects, you need to make your measurements very accurately, and this scale will enable you to do that. Stay away from those that are not marked or that are in other dimensions. In other words, this is a English scale. It's in 32nd, 16ths, eighths and quarters, so on, whereas the machinist scales are in tenths of an inch, and they're more difficult to read. So this is the very one I recommend. It's a general, and as I say, it's available for less than $2. You'll use tape, and the tape I recommend is this blue painter's tape. You can buy this at a home supply store or at a paint store. Regular masking tape doesn't work very well, and it's a low cost item. One roll will last you for a very long time, so I would recommend this particular brand. When you're taping your projects, and we do tape them, you just take a very small piece of tape and you tape only about the last half to quarter of an inch, and I say tape flat. By that I mean you just lay it behind that, then you bring this over and tape it to the side. And the reason you use that is once you tape that, it holds it securely, but it's very easy to take off if you only tape that quarter to a half inch long. Whereas other tapes stick so tightly that you almost distort your wire getting it off. We use a pen vise, and I recommend this particular one. It's rather difficult to find, but we use this for twisting wire. And in the individual projects, I'll show you how to twist wire. Depending on the type of the wire, we twist different types in a different fashion. The essential thing here is that you have a small hole here, not one that will rip the wire, but you can tighten down very tightly like that. It needs to be hollow, because when you're twisting wire, you'll put it in one end, and sometimes you have a lot of wire out here, and particularly with half hard wire, which I'll describe a little bit later, you can only twist a couple of inches at a time. So you twist a couple of inches, loosen this, move the wire down, twist a couple more inches, move it down, twist again. And as I say, I'll go through that in the individual projects. I use jeweler's rouge for polishing. Again, I use that in conjunction with the Dremel, and it works really well. It's a very low cost item. It will last you for years and years. Although that pretty much covers the essential items, I'll go into some others now that are optional but desirable and will make your work easier. And they're not that expensive either. First, I have this tool holder, which I made many, many years ago. It just has a series of half-inch and 3/8-inch holes, and I put my pliers in it depending on the size of the handle. I've got these little grooves over here, which I put in with the Dremel. And they more or less hold them in alignment. I keep it right in front of me, and I put the pliers in when I'm not using them. It makes it very easy just to reach forward and grab that. And it holds most of the essential tools, the pliers, the wire twister. I usually have my scale in here, got my marker, and again, this little file. So it's very handy, and it keeps things cleaned up. Another optional device is this work surface that I have, and I hope to get plans on it soon on my website. But it's just a piece of quarter inch plywood. It's about 18 inches wide and roughly 15 inches deep. The beauty of this is you can clamp it anywhere, even on a very nice table with something underneath. Use a deep C clamp, that is one that's wide from here to here, from the front to the back. And you can clamp it under inside the support of the table down here. And as I say, it helps you work anywhere, because I've got a scale here. I don't have to pick up this scale for intermediate cutting. I can just pull a wire out, measure it, and cut it here. And then as I cut shorter and shorter pieces of wire, this little fence keeps those wires on the table. They don't fall in the carpet or on the floor. Underneath, I've got a 2x4 here, and this 2x4 is drilled about 2.5 inches deep. The 2x4 is 3.5 inches, so it's not drilled completely through, and it holds the ring mandrel. So for beginners, especially for beginners, by using it this way, you have both hands to work with, and it's a much more flexible system than what most wire wrappers use. So I highly recommend this. It's very inexpensive to make, very easy to make, and gives you a lot more flexibility as to where you can work. Optional tools are just additional tools that will make it easier for you to work. And so I'll go through those again. Some of them are not very expensive at all, and you'll really appreciate having them. The first of those are the battery-powered Dremels. This particular one is the least expensive Dremel you can buy. Right now, I think it's in the $25 range at the larger stores. Home stores or discount department stores. It's a 4.8 volt model. It has two speeds. I always use it on high speed, which is number two. You can interchange your tools. I use primarily just two tools. And the first is a rubberized abrasive. And this particular one is a fine. I use this for deburring, taking tool marks out of my projects if I happen to get one there, and polishing prongs. The other is a soft cotton buff. This is started out as a 1-inch cotton buff, and that's strictly for polishing. So you just put those in, lock the shaft with this little knob, cut it, and turn it on. And again, you just hit it like that, and then you just bounce it off your project like this. And it does a wonderful job of polishing. It gives your work a very professional finish, highly polished finish, and it's invaluable. These run around $25 to $30. They last for years. It has a rechargeable battery and several mandrels and tools with it, several of these. The ones that you use, you'll have to buy from a jewelry supply. That is the 1-inch cotton buff and the rubberized abrasive. You'll also have to buy the mandrels. That's this portion of it. When you're doing that, buy all 1/8-inch mandrels. That way you don't have to change the collets inside here, and that will help you keep your pace of work up a little higher. None of these things are very expensive. They're under $2 a piece, and they will last you, you know, for years. And the other optional categories are pliers. In some cases, these are specialized pliers. In others, they're just variations on sizes to do different sizes of projects. For instance, here are two different sizes of chain nose pliers. Either will work. Smaller pair will enable you to do a little bit finer work. And I prepare these pliers. I prepare the chain nose and the flat nose pliers before I work with them. By that, I mean I use a rubberized abrasive in the Dremel, and I come along and I take the wire edge off. If you will feel new pliers like this before they're prepared, they have just a bit of an edge, and it feels sharp. And that sharp edge will mark your wire as you're working with them if you don't take it off. So I just use rubberized abrasive in the Dremel and just run along that. I also just imperceptibly round the points on the outside. I don't do anything to the inside of the jaw, but around the outside. And on the flat nose, I do the same thing, just around here and on the outside. But I never do anything to the inside of the jaw where you're actually grasping the wire. Regarding flat nose, I have several sets of flat nose pliers, and they all have somewhat of a special purpose. This is the first one I showed you. It's the best all-around plier, probably. The jaw width here is about 3/16 of an inch. I have a larger, stronger pair, and I use this strictly to make rosettes, and I also make a chain with this, which I demonstrate in the tapes. I file reference marks on these various flat nose pliers, and that helps me be consistent in my work. And for instance, in making a chain, then I can make the lengths of the chain all the same length by doing a reference mark. And I go through that pretty thoroughly in the tape as to how to develop and mark that reference mark. These, again, for rosettes and for making chains, they're very heavy through here and through here. They're a specialized plier, but they're not expensive. Again, a very inexpensive pair will work just fine if you can find them. So side by side, you'll see a big difference in these. I'll try to get them here in graduated widths. Large one for, again, making rosettes and chain links. This would be an all-around set. Its jaw width is about 1/4 inch. This one's slightly smaller. This would be my best all-around plier, flat nose. As you can see, this one is very small, less than 1/8 inch. And I use this especially on prong projects and other very fine flat nose requirements. Again, these three would run in the $7 to $10 range. Some other specialized pliers that I use a lot, primarily for shaping and sculpting wire, scrolling wire, and forming it, are these. They're called by several names. They're called combination pliers. They're called flat nose, round nose, and I've heard people call them coiling pliers as well. As you can see, if you look at the end of the jaw, one's round, one's completely flat, and they work very well for certain applications, like making small loops. You get out right there on the end, and then just keep backing up and go forever, or you can actually spiral this down the round part of it to get a decorative effect. This is a much smaller plier. You can make the same version of this combination plier. You can make a very, very tiny loop with these pliers. And they're very handy. I think these will be awfully hard to find. These you see sometimes at gem and mineral shows, or some of the better jewelry suppliers will have these too. Along the same lines is a larger pair. As you can see, these have a very large radius on top and a flat nose on the bottom. And where they work particularly well is shaping gentle curves like this when you're trying to get an exact fit. They and make the job much easier. There's always another way on all of these things. For instance, this, you can use a combination of round nose and wooden dowels and things like that. But truthfully, that plier makes the work much easier. Another highly recommended requirement is that when you work with some kind of magnification. Now, this is an optivizer. I consider it the best of the magnifying devices. You can easily adjust this to the size of your head by moving this knob back here. These fall in the $30 to $35 range, but I've got several pair of them. I've had them for, in one case, I think I've had a pair probably 35 years. You can buy replacement parts for these, and if you're going to work all day for or very long periods, these are the most desirable from my point of view. An acceptable substitute for those of you that aren't doing it professionally or for long periods is just magnifying reading glasses. And in my classes, this is generally what I wear. They don't magnify as much as these, but for most work, they work just fine. The last fundamental I would like to cover is the wire that you use. There's a lot to know about wire. For most of my work, I use 20, 21, and 22 gauge in both half hard and soft or dead soft strengths. I use almost all gold filled. You can also use silver in the same configurations. And all of the wire, well, 99.9% of the wire I use is square wire. When you buy it, you need to buy it, you do buy it by the ounce. And this is a couple of ounces of square wire. This particular one is soft wire. And when you have both soft and half hard wire in front of you, you can tell the difference between them by just taking the end of it and flicking the end like that. You can see this bend very easily. The half hard wire has a lot of spring to it, and it'll come right back and won't bend that easily. It's very important that you use the right wire for the right project. And by that I mean the projects that I talk about on the tapes. I tell you exactly what wire to use, whether it's hard, half hard. I also tell you the gauge. I work mostly in gold filled wire, but you can also use silver wire. That's not silver. Sometimes I use them in combination. For instance, this bracelet, I don't know if you can see it on the tape, but there's silver wire, and on the outside I have gold filled wire. It's a nice look, the combination. Silver wire works a little differently than gold filled, but you can easily adjust. In all my years, I have never found an acceptable practice wire. And I get a lot of questions about that. The copper wire is too soft. The brass wire is too hard. none of the less expensive wires works like gold felt. Silver is the closest. Right now, as we're making the tapes, the gold wire runs probably $20 to $22 an ounce, and you buy it by the ounce. An ounce of 22 gauge wire, which this is about 25 feet long. The average project takes probably 4 feet of wire, so you can make roughly six projects from 1 ounce of 22 gauge gold felled wire. So it costs roughly $1 a foot for the wire. Down in the 20 gauge, which is heavier, the gauges, the bigger the number, the smaller the wire. In other words, 22 gauge or 16 gauge is much thicker than 22 gauge or 24 gauge. You, as I said before, you must use the right wire for the right project. As a general rule of thumb, if you're doing a project that has a lot of detail where you, and where you need strength, you'll use half hard wire. And the term half hard and hard are used synonymously. They're the same wire in this country. And the term soft and dead soft are synonymous. But again, where you need a lot of detail and strength, you'll use half hard wire. Where you have flowing curves and you know, you do scroll work, soft wire is the choice. In other words, if you tried to do this project with half hard wire, it would not be successful. You wouldn't get the smooth flowing lines. You wouldn't get, you know, it's just not manipulated as easy. And those projects that require half hard wire, use your tools and pliers a lot more than you do your fingers. That said, probably 80% of the work you do with in wire art is done with your fingers.